Hi, my name is Terry. I'm a subscriber to Channel 11, WTTW, Chicago.
Good evening. I'm David Susskind. Whether you know it or not, Americans are obsessed with class. Now, what is class? Who has class? And who hasn't got it? Stay tuned. My guests are going to tell you all about it. And part two is the ultimate seduction. It'll be explained by the author of a new book by that title, Charlotte Channel. We'll begin after this part. There's a lot of talk these days about class. Does he have class? Does she have class? Do I have class? The question is, what is class? Who has it and who hasn't got it? Well, my guests tonight are experts, and they have strong opinions on this subject of class. Please meet them now. First, Bonita Eisler has been arts producer for two public television programs, and she currently teaches literature at Princeton University. She's the author of Class Act, America's Last Dirty Secret. Paul Fussell is professor of English at the University of Pennsylvania, and he is a contributing editor to New Republic magazine. He won the National Book Award in 1976 for The Great War and Modern Memory, and he's just written Class, a Guide Through the American Status System. Terry Toll is a partner in a Manhattan law firm and an established record critic, classical records. He's also host of a weekly radio show on WBAI-FM in New York City. All right, what is class? It's tone. It's... I know what it is. I don't know how to define it.
It's style, too.
All right.
Well, it's very hard to define, but what I think it is what a person feels about himself in relation to a social hierarchy. Everybody wants to be unique. And
not everybody. Well, today's kids want to be like each other.
No, but they want to be a little different from the next person. They want to have an identity. You know, that's why they have different names. And when you begin thinking about what your relation is to other people, you rank yourself unconsciously, either as better or worse than they are, or as luckier or as unluckier.
Do you think you're better than other people?
I don't judge myself according to that standard. There are certain respects, I think, in which every one of us thinks that he or she is better than somebody else or worse than somebody else.
What respects?
Well, whatever our particular skills or innate talents are. Class to me is an innate sense of security, an innate sense of, if you will, dignity about the self and one's ability to relate to somebody else. In trying to define it, I can't help but think of Potter Stewart's famous remark about pornography. I know it when I see it, but don't ask me to define it.
Isn't it also what other people think of us? It's not just how we rank ourselves. That could be not very realistic. How do other people see us in terms of class?
I don't know. Do you think he has class, Fussell?
Absolutely. Every other author has class.
But David, I like Terry's suggesting that it has to do with something other than money. It has to do with style, security, comfort, psychological ease, something like that. Not being scared of what other people think of you is a large part of class.
I would say that a person who has class wouldn't give a damn about the two books that you've both written. It's completely immaterial to them as to if you say that X has class and Y does not, whether it's an object or a person, to somebody who has class, those judgments are completely immaterial.
Exactly. And amusing.
It really has a lot to do with Duke Ellington's definition of jazz when the woman asked him what is jazz, and he said, if you got to ask, you'll never know.
All right, now let's be specific. Who has class in our 1980 society?
Most blacks have class because they've got style.
Oh, come on. What a safe liberal generalization.
But it's true.
You're a knee-jerk liberal.
That's right. Proud of it. One of the last to be pleased with that definition.
I knew there was one left. Who has class?
I can't think of anybody right at the moment that I'd like to present as a person who has class, but I can tell you one thing that helps define the idea.
President Reagan have class?
As I say in my book, Jack Kennedy was once watching Nixon on the television early on in their encounter, and he was sitting there with a lot of people in a hotel room watching Nixon, and he was appalled, of course, by this person. And he turned to his aides after the program was over, and he said, the guy has no class. Now, he didn't mean that he didn't speak the right words, or that he didn't have enough money, wasn't wearing the right clothes.
Had great political skill.
Well, he was nervous. He was anxious.
All right.
People who have class are never anxious.
Richard Nixon has no class. President Reagan?
None whatever.
All right. Vice President Bush?
A little more.
That's only because he has the right connections and went to the right schools. I don't think he has innate class.
Walter Mondale?
No, he doesn't have an innate class.
I would. Walter Mondale is not somebody who, to me, has class. As far as George Bush is concerned, I'm inclined to disagree with you. That may be because we went to some of the same schools, but that's besides the
point.
He's
simply a man from Connecticut who moved to Texas.
Well, he has the kind of class you can pick up at certain schools. You
know, he went to Choate and
Yale.
He
wears the right clothes, and he has a long neck, and he stands up straight, and he knows how to sail.
Well, by that definition, Bill Buckley has got to be the classiest, because he has a long neck, he stands straight, and went to Yale.
I think he has a lot of class.
I do too. I think so. I do too.
All right, let's get George Will has more class than Bill Buckley.
Definitely.
Okay.
I'll go for that.
Let's think of
because he has more originality.
Oh, he's got
style.
One of the best brains in the country.
Yeah.
Is George
Will. Our brains class. Now,
yes.
There's an interesting question.
Yeah, I think intelligence is class, but letting it show too much is not classy. One should take it easy.
Oh, boy.
Understated intelligence.
Understated, yeah. In my book, I make a great thing about the relation of understatement to class. It's all going to be understated. You know, driving a big, showy car is not classy. Driving a dirty, inexpensive one.
I don't agree. I think that is a statement that lacks class.
In other words, Woody Allen is a genius, a comedic genius as a director, actor, writer. But he's not a classy person because, and he dresses in all those terrible dungarees. He has a car that's dirty, if he has a car at all.
Yeah, but his whole persona is...
He walks around with eyeglasses, shades, you know, what do you call them, sunglasses.
Yeah.
I think Woody Allen has tons of class.
Mm-hmm.
He has the class to be a nebbish. That is the ultimate class statement.
Elizabeth Taylor.
I think just the opposite, Benita. I think he is totally lacking in class.
Of course he is.
I think certainly he has the security to be a nebbish. But whether that is a question of choice or just something natural is something altogether different.
He has done more for the $2.98 plaid button-down shirt than any other living human being in the Western world. Is that not class?
As an acknowledged bleeding-heart liberal, you've almost ruled yourself out.
I can't talk about Woody Allen's plaid shirts because I'm a bleeding-heart liberal. That would, it seem to me, qualify me preeminently.
What about Dick Cavett?
Too nervous.
Johnny Carson.
He has class.
Yes, he does.
Because he's secure. He's very calm. He does beautifully what he does.
He's cool. He's elegant.
Yeah.
And he's imperturbable.
Yeah.
And he couldn't care less about what the world thinks.
Absolutely. That's important.
Let's see who else is there. Merv Griffin.
No. No. I'd say he's a high pro by my definition of people.
High pro.
He's a high proletarian. Yeah. Which is one reason he's so popular. I mean, people like him.
He reminds you of your brother.
Well,
or an uncle.
You can patronize
not
him.
Not Paul's brother.
Not mine, sir. You can patronize him implicitly.
Walter Cronkite.
He's a little
has
dumber
class.
Than almost everybody
Eric
watches.
Sevareid has class.
Eric Sevareid. Walter Cronkite has enormous class.
Mm-hmm. I agree.
David Brickley, quintessential class.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
John
On the other
Chancellor.
Hand, what's his name?
Dan Rather.
Yeah. He doesn't have much.
No,
he's
doesn't.
A little too nervous.
Yeah, well, he's Texas.
He's a striver. I think if you're a striver,
you can see him working
hard.
You know?
Yeah, he gives the impression he's very ambitious. Which is wrong.
You can't huff and
Chuck
puff
Scarborough
and
has class.
Yeah.
Let's see, women. It's hard to find women with class.
Well, they're all pretty old dying, like Rose Kennedy.
Yeah, Rose Kennedy has enormous class.
Yeah.
Does Lady Bird have class?
Yes.
I think she has class.
Yeah. How about Katharine Hepburn?
Yes.
Betty Davis.
Very class.
Katharine Hepburn camps class.
Yeah, she works too hard.
She has an excess.
Yeah. I would
what
say
about
that.
People have an excess of class?
Yeah. Right. Okay.
Well, if you have an excess,
over to the other side,
she's working too hard at being
that's
classy.
Right. Yeah.
Yes, and she also from time to time betrays the lack of class in the way that she deals with certain segments of the public.
Mm-hmm.
And, for example, the way she has been known to be pretty damn abusive to photographers and the like.
Yeah.
Yes, well,
I admit it certainly is an annoyance, but just some of
Betty
the stories.
Betty Davis has class.
Oh, definitely.
Class.
Definitely.
She's the classiest actress that ever lived.
Yeah, lots of it. How about Grace Kelly?
No.
That's in my category of excessive
a little
class.
Too innocent, I think.
No, she's a manufactured Philadelphia lady who went to, I mean, she's a, I love that city of Philadelphia, but she was a society girl who went wrong. Mm-hmm.
How'd she go wrong? By
being an
pro?
Actress, having a lot of affairs, and, you know what she did.
That's a very puritanical. If I'm the last of the knee-jerk liberals, you are an old-style Puritan, even about class, never mind morality. You can't have lots of affairs and be a professional working actress and have class.
I will come back to that. I never want to be accused of evading an answer, but it's time for me to pause. We'll be right back.
Have affairs and be classy.
You can't have affairs and be classy. Let's get on with this. You can't. We've not touched on corporate world.
Well, I think I'm probably going to have a contract put out on me for saying this or some other such awful thing. But there are two people in the corporate world who come immediately to mind in my book who are totally lacking in class. One of them is Rupert Murdoch and the other one is Henry Ford.
How about Freddie Laker?
Well, wait, answer.
I can't answer. I don't know these people.
You don't know who
Well,
Rupert
I know
Murdoch.
One of them. Well, you're
why
wrong.
Why
does
Rupert Murdoch have class? Because he's Australian? Because he's a pirateer?
I think he's just...
Gross.
It's an intangible. He's crass.
Yes.
He's just
like
unbelievably
glasses,
crass.
He lacks subtlety and he produces terrible newspapers.
And the reflection of his personality that one finds in the periodicals that he acquires and then changes, whether it's the New York Post or the London Times.
Or the Chicago Sun-Times.
Or the Chicago Sun-Times. It's just downright crass.
Yeah.
It's the same mentality that... to go back two or three generations, allowed William Randolph Hearst to hang Van Dyke's in the dining hall and have bottles of ketchup on the table. As far as I'm concerned, ketchup is not class.
Agreed.
Even if you call
what
it catsup.
What about mustard?
Well, depends on what kind
not
of
on
mustard,
the table.
I think.
Not on the table. In this
I think what you're saying is interesting. What you're implying is that if you exercise power by means of money, you probably don't have much class. That the class requires a degree of restraint, not taking advantage of things when you might.
It requires a certain dignity, I think, in the way that you exercise power, in the way that you take advantage, if you will, of the privilege that power and money happen to give you.
But aren't you all talking about money that turns out to be a few generations removed? Your objection to money allied with power doesn't produce class.
No, wait, you're getting too theoretical. I want to, please. You said Rupert Murdoch has no class. Agreed. Henry Ford has class.
I'm sorry. I emphatically disagree with you.
Well, you don't know him.
Quite the contrary. I may not know him personally, but I know an awful lot of people who do. And when Albert Bradley, God rest his soul, who was the chairman of the board of General Motors, said that Henry Ford lacked class, I'll agree with Albert any step of the week, any day of the week. Any man who would allow himself to get into the kind of battles that he has gotten himself into, whether with his wives or the people who work with him,
has been unlucky.
Has lacking in class.
Henry
he's been
Ford.
Damn lucky, as a matter of fact, that he has gotten as far as he has gotten, considering some of the things that he's done.
Are you saying, though, Terry,
Henry Ford has class. Let's come to somebody else. The Rockefellers have class.
I agree.
The Mellons
All
have
the
class.
Rockefellers have class? Every single one?
Well, all the brothers. Well, Nelson.
Did Nelson have class?
No.
Now you're getting back to your puritanical views on sex. I mean, how do you tally those with saying that Nelson Rockefeller had class?
Nelson didn't.
Nelson didn't because he was too visible. Part of having class, if you've got a great deal of money, is to be as invisible as possible. The Mellons are a good example. You never see them. They never run for office. They just give the National Gallery to the country. I mean, that's classy.
Well, that's visibility.
Well, so do the Rockefellers.
That's conspicuous consumption of a very public and insecure kind, if I can play the devil's advocate for a moment.
They also gave the National Gallery because of owing back taxes. It was preferable to going to jail.
Yeah, but you mustn't explore all that depth. Otherwise, the Whitneys, the Astors, the, all of them.
But you're saying class is a cover-up if you say that we're not exploring those depths.
No.
If you're not looking
all
at
all of the Rockefellers, with the exception of Nelson, have class. Lawrence, David.
Mm-hmm.
Winthrop didn't have class.
Because he lived in Arkansas?
No, because he had affairs that became public.
There he goes again.
Yes, but I noticed an interesting double standard there, because, I mean, after all, Winthrop Rockefeller got himself into the same kind of difficulties with Bobo that Henry Ford got himself into with one of his wives. And according to you, Henry Ford has class, but Winthrop Rockefeller doesn't.
Affairs are not the determinant where men are concerned.
Oh, that's an interesting double standard, too. Is it the determinant where women are concerned?
It's a very important factor if the women's lives become public notice.
Why less so if the men's lives?
We're not here to debate that. All right. Movie stars. Elizabeth Taylor?
No, not whatever.
None. Faye Dunaway?
Perhaps.
I don't know. Jane Fonda has class.
No. No, emphatically not.
None at all.
Emphatically not.
Class to...
Anyone who exercises publicly, by definition, doesn't have class.
Of course not.
She doesn't exercise publicly, commercially. She sells it.
There's a difference?
Of course. It's a business with Jane Fonda. And she has the class to have outrageous opinions and go against the tide.
She takes herself seriously. Now, that's very bad from the class point of view. You must have a degree of levity about yourself. You must think you're pretty comic underneath, or else you're going to be anxious and nervous and strident. Jane gets strident, you know? She gets too serious.
She was younger.
But her sister...
But now she's strident about exercise.
Her stepsister, Brooke Haywood. Brooke Haywood has class.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Yeah.
Whatever became of her.
That's one of the reasons why she has class. I saw her at a party at Bill Buckley's last October, however.
Obscurity is class? Is that what you're telling us? What an awful fate.
There's nothing obscure about Brooke Haywood. I mean, she wrote Haywire.
But aren't you just saying whatever became of? I mean, that's a one-way trip to obscurity.
Whoever we say that about, that doesn't determine class or the lack of it. It only determines our personal ignorance as to the whereabouts and the doings of a particular individual.
Mm. I didn't agree with anything he said ever, but Douglas MacArthur had class.
What about Patton?
Patton, no.
No, I thought Eisenhower, when he was a general, had more class than MacArthur because he was less flamboyant. He showed off less.
Franklin Roosevelt was the ultimate
class man. Yeah.
Ultimate class.
Yeah. One thing I loved about Roosevelt, and one thing that gave him a lot of class.
Truman had class.
I loved Roosevelt's independence with dress. I mean, the cigarette holder, the pince-nez, the naval cape, the horrible fedora.
He's an aristocrat by birth and by character.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And consequently, a deep Democrat. And so one of the great paradoxes, I think.
Yeah.
Truman, a bomb boy.
Aristocrats are Democratic?
Not all, but that's the most profound Democrats are always true aristocrats.
Yeah.
Harry Truman had class.
Well, he earned it, I'd say. He didn't start with it, I think, but I think...
Well, it can be bucolic.
Yeah.
It can be rural.
Yeah, he got it as he went on.
Well, I think in Truman's case, I mean, we'll forgive him his flamboyant Hawaiian shirts, but Truman's class was the kind of class that's based on a certain innate security.
Mm-hmm.
And truth, character.
Honesty.
Mm-hmm. Honesty.
Yeah, he never faked it once.
Mark Twain has class.
Mm-hmm.
Well,
Ernest Hemingway has no class.
Well, occasionally.
No, macho.
Can you acquire it if you don't start with it?
Yes.
I think so.
You can, yeah.
Mm-hmm. And how should we talk about going about it? How would you acquire it if you don't start with it?
Well, I don't know.
You read up?
No.
You read Paul and my book?
No, the first thing to do is for everybody to lose about 15 pounds, because thin...
Fat is never class.
No, fat is never classy. And this is why Elizabeth Taylor is in constant class trouble.
Well, she's classless.
Well, I would say that Winston Churchill had class, and he could have definitely done to have lost about 30 or 40 pounds when he was in his prime.
De Gaulle was thin, tall, and had class. Mm-hmm.
Churchill might have had more class had he been thinner.
But he was the last of the Victorians, and Victorians could be hugely obese and have lots of class.
Like President
they ate all those 12 course dinners.
Sadat had class.
Bingham had class. Mm-hmm. Primitive class.
Mm-hmm.
Golda Meir had class. Mitterrand has no class. Margaret Thatcher has class.
Mm. How about the royal family?
None. They're middle class. Royal family.
Middle class.
Utterly middle class.
Well, you see, I don't agree entirely with that. I think the Queen Mother has class.
Oh, yes.
She's not quite the contrary. The Queen Mother is not retired, and the Queen there's a certain dignity. There is a certain naturalness about the woman. This is a woman who can go out and be everybody's grandmother, the symbolic grandmother of a nation, and she does it so naturally, so easily, and so well that you cannot say that the woman lacks class.
She is an queen that looks like the symbolic grandmother of a nation.
That's an unfair yeah. remark. Class yeah. is an intangible. Class is not determined by whether one is wearing a blue pinstripe suit or a pair of narrow whale corduroy mm-hmm. trousers or, you know, a diamond tiara that was made in the 19th century and that sold at Christie's for $776,000 or whatever. That's not a determinant. It's something innate. It's an aura.
Yeah, something like poise. Compare the Queen Mother with, say, Princess Anne.
Oh, my Princess Anne.
The one has
definitely
class,
lacks
the other
it.
Doesn't because she's cussing.
Princess Anne, Princess Margaret,
cool.
Prince Andrew, they yeah. have no class. Yeah. The Queen okay. Mother is quintessential class.
Yeah. Poise is important, however you define
we
it.
We have to. Queen Mother is the apogee of class. We will be back in a minute. Let's talk about objects, cars.
Well, one of the things that I noticed, that Mr. Fussell has an obsession with the Mercedes-Benz, mm. and he says it's not class. And I think, in essence, nowadays he's right. He made an observation to me before we went on the air that it was in... on Wilshire Boulevard that he discovered that Rolls Royces are vulgar.
Oh,
and
no.
I said that depends on the color.
Color. Mm-hmm.
But as far as a Mercedes is concerned, let's take things like Mercedes, Benzes,
BMW,
Louis Vuitton luggage, that sort of thing. I would submit to you that a lady of elegance from the 1920s or the 1930s who has been traveling with a suite of luggage since the 1920s can continue to travel with it and not be accused of not having, of lacking class mm. simply because she's done what she's always done. The person who, the Cadillac of yesterday is the Mercedes-Benz of today as a classless object, and the BMW is destined to be the classless object of tomorrow.
Yeah, yeah.
But
sure
the
enough.
Person who got in on the ground floor with particular object in question as a class object can continue with impunity to use it, as
well,
far as
Well, what you're
as
saying,
I'm
Terry,
concerned.
Is that the more people that can afford to own something, the less class it has.
Well, the more people
we
who can afford...
Vuitton luggage in 1984 is simply unthinkable.
That's well, what I'm...
In the sense of class.
Mm-hmm.
It means you want to say you've got money because there are
the person who goes out and buys it in 1984 may be seeking to make that statement, but the person who has had it, the person who is driving a 1971 Mercedes 280 SE 4.5, can have class in a way that somebody who goes in and buys whatever the latest 450 or whatever is yep. might well not have class.
All right.
But let's go back to the much maligned Vuitton luggage.
No American car has class, except perhaps dimly the Cadillac.
Checker cab.
Oh, come
because
on.
Because they're an endangered species. I mean, this man is the most nostalgic human being that ever was. I mean, anything that's on
my
book.
Let's talk about...
It's classy.
Let's talk about...
Because it's pre-democratic.
People who wear labels of clothes where you can identify the designer or a pocketbook that says Vittorio Gassman on it or something. That's unthinkable.
Those are
classless, yeah. All right, let's come to places, resorts.
As far as I'm concerned, there's not a resort in the world that has class.
Monte Carlo.
Monte Carlo does not have... I don't... This doesn't matter which...
Well, I know one that does.
Some of them may have segments that are class... that are class because of the people who populate them. For example, mm-hmm. let's just take Palm Beach because everybody talks about Palm Beach.
Not on this program.
Well, let's take Miami. There are certain parts of Miami that are class and certain parts that definitely are not. And the same thing is true of Palm Beach. And in Palm Beach, you can literally cross the street and go from class to lack of class.
Mm-hmm. I'm not familiar with Palm Beach. May we move on to Monte Carlo? I am familiar with that.
Rottenbottom is about the only resort that I could think of that could conceivably
Monte
have
Carlo
class.
Monte Carlo has no class.
No.
Now. It used to have class. Mm-hmm. But Cap d'Antibes, Hotel de Cap, that area, that has class.
But what about the resorts that are passé? Does Biarritz still have class?
No.
I think all resorts are passé.
Well, I hate them with a passé.
Palm Springs, for example,
no
is
one with class stays at a hotel for a vacation.
Bonita.
You stay with friends, don't you?
Yes, or you have your own house.
Bonita.
Yeah. But that's...
You want your own show? Or
yeah.
You know? All right. What about Palm Springs, California? Out of no class.
No class. The wrong people live there.
Yeah. Too bad.
But who defined... Mm-hmm.
The Bahamas.
Oh,
no.
Acapulco.
Worse.
Cuernavaca, yes. Acapulco.
Cuernavaca, yes. Yeah. Okay. Acapulco, Las Brisas, and the private homes, perhaps. Mm-hmm.
Well.
Yes.
How about places around here? Just
Saint-Tropez?
Where does living in the summer give you class? Long
South
Island?
Aston. Southampton. No,
no,
the element class
South
would
Hampton
be Connecticut.
Is now a classless act.
How about Martha's Vineyard?
Name Martha's Cronkite. Vineyard, yes.
Mm-hmm. Islands.
Any place Walter Cronkite is class.
Mm-hmm. Very easy to play.
He's on the vineyard. And any place James Reston of New York Times is class.
Yes, I think the vineyard's very classy. I've never been there. I just
well,
hear
Nantucket,
about
Nantucket, I would say, is, yes. From what I've been told about it, is a class place.
But
certainly the people that I know who go there whom I consider to have class.
Southampton, no. Getting a bit gross.
Out.
Yeah.
So well, this is, and for that reason, they're getting ready to ruin one of the most beautiful parts of this area in an attempt to establish class, and that's
East
upstate
Hampton.
Connecticut.
Mm. East Hampton.
Oh, East Hampton is teeter-totter, I mean. And once again, it's a question of you literally can cross the street and go from a class part of the town to a non-class part of the town.
No, but it's a cultured place. The authors are there, the dramatists are there, the novelists are there.
And the nouveau riche are there.
well, some of them.
They follow on along very fast behind the authors. Yeah.
West Hampton is unthinkable mm-hmm. in class terms. East Hampton is classy.
Well, I would submit to you that the people who have class are likely not to think of a community like that where they want to take a house for the summer or where they want to summer as opposed mm-hmm. to, rather mm-hmm. than to use summer as a
well,
verb.
The class people yeah. inherited
but,
the house.
Yes. Well, not necessarily. Some people go out and, you know, they choose a house on the basis of what it offers for the purpose that they want a place of relaxation for.
What about Cape Cod?
And to have the security to do that is an indicia of class, if you ask me. Mm-hmm. An
indicia,
I guess.
It's good.
That's a
word.
Great word.
I've got a question for you all. Which is classier, a hot dog or a quiche?
A hot dog.
Right.
A hot dog.
And there's the principle.
Basic.
Understatement, unpretentiousness. Taking
quiche.
For granted things that one has instead
nouveau
of pouring after the exotic and the showy.
Yes,
that's what class involves that. That's not all class is.
But once again, we go back to that question of when you started eating quiche. Mm-hmm. I would submit that somebody who has been quietly making and enjoying quiche since 1945.
For 40 years, yeah.
For 40 years.
God, how dull.
What about someone who lifelong has hated quiche?
Yes. Like
I don't like quiche.
I'm not particularly fond of it either. But
let's take... Other places, Martha's Vineyard, we did that. But what about Cape Cod?
That's where I go for the summer.
Ogunquit,
I don't
Maine.
Summer there, I go there.
Ogunquit has class in a way that Bar Harbor no longer
yeah.
has class.
Ogunquit, Maine has class.
Yeah, on the Cape, Truro has class.
Yes.
Because
a lot of
yep. people in letters have lived there. Provincetown has less.
Yeah.
You see, because it's rowdy.
And, you know,
what
the Kennedy
raffish,
area.
What about though? There's a word
where?
I love. Can you be raffish and have class as opposed to rowdy in a place?
If you do it in a style that's interesting.
Yeah. Yeah, like Errol Flynn had no class. But
Errol Flynn was totally lacking in class.
And everything else.
And everything else, including morals of any kind.
Yeah.
Why do sailboats have so much class and motorboats not?
Interesting question. Because it takes a degree of skill to run them.
That's
sailboats.
It's largely a skill that is taught you by your forebears.
Family.
I mean, you cannot learn to sail a 40-foot schooner by taking lessons. Your father, your relatives have to teach you. You have to learn with your brothers and sisters.
Suppose you took a crash intensive course.
You'd never be good at it. You'd always be nervous.
A canoe has class. A rowboat.
A canoe has infinitely more class than a Chris Craft.
Yeah. And a canoe has more class than a rowboat.
As far as I'm concerned,
because
if it's less than 500 feet long, it doesn't have class to me.
Like, the Queen Mary had class. Queen Elizabeth has class.
Mm-hmm.
But there are
the
ships out there.
The old Queen Elizabeth had class. The new one doesn't.
New
only, if
in
you're
more
in
ways
the,
than one.
Only if you're in the grill room for your meals.
The Titanic had the most class of all.
Because it went down?
Yes.
Oh, come on. What is the ultimate? Does she have class?
I think we all do. That's a given. We wouldn't be here if we didn't.
Oh, that's right. All right. Even though she's a liberal. Do you have anything more to say about class?
I've learned talking about it and writing about it that it's a very dangerous subject. It embarrasses people as much as talking about sex embarrasses them 100 years.
In some ways, it's a synonym for character, tone,
taste.
Dignity, nobility.
I suppose so, yeah. A security, a relaxation, coolness.
Serenity.
Serenity is a good word, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. You've been terrific, and I've enjoyed it. I've had a lot of fun.
Thank you very much. I hope some
of the people aren't too angry forever. Though the ones with class won't be.
Which includes all your listeners and viewers.
That's true. We'll be back.
Charlotte Chandler's very first book, Hello, I Must Be Going, was all about Groucho Marx, and it became a big bestseller. Her latest book, The Ultimate Seduction, is just out on the stands, and it's going to be a big bestseller. It is a compilation of interviews with some of the most famous people in the world. I want to quickly say that The Ultimate Seduction, Charlotte, correct me if I'm wrong, The Ultimate Seduction is the work you love, it's not a sexy book.
That's right. It comes from something Picasso told me. When I went to see him, he told me, the passions in life change, but it is your work that is the ultimate seduction.
That's a wonderful phrase. And the ultimate distraction is a love affair.
That seems to be a quick one, a long one, depending on the person. Maybe one that lasts your whole life, if you're very lucky.
The love affair.
Mm-hmm.
Well, that's a marriage then, right?
If you're lucky.
Right. Well, may I show evidence that you have indeed been with all these great people? Here is Charlotte Chandler when she did the interview with Groucho Marx, which is in The Ultimate Seduction. And then here she is with Tennessee Williams. And then she's with Lillian Gish, I believe, I hope. I've got the right card, Lillian Gish. And here she is with Federico Fellini, the master movie maker.
We're on the set of And the Ship Sails, his new film.
Oh, really?
Mm-hmm.
And finally, Fellini evidently liked you a lot because he then did a crayon sketch of you.
That's Charlatina, and it's a caricature of me. In the caricature, he drew me with gold earrings.
Right.
And I asked him why I'd drawn the gold earrings, because I really don't wear gypsy earrings or dress that way. And he said, you wear them inside.
Now, why do you wear your hair the way you do and dress the way you do so kind of conservatively and a little obscure? Are you trying to be faceless?
Well, I don't think so in life, but in the book, to some extent.
No, in life, you're very much like the book. In other words, you're not visible in the book. There is no Charlotte Chandler imprint. The questions are sort of traditional questions. You don't abrade anybody.
Well, actually, in the conversations, I don't really have very many questions. And the people often say, where are your questions? Now, I do have some, but they're in my head if I need them. Otherwise, I'd really like the other person to kind of guide the way it goes. And what comes out of it is what happens. I didn't have this theme in mind when I met Picasso or when I talked with any of the people. But it grew out of what all the people said, because it was the constantly recurring thought that for all of them, their work was everything in their lives. It gave them everything.
Well,
they gave
all of them.
Everything.
Let's say there's Fellini, there's Henry Moore, there's Mae West, Groucho Marx, Henry Fonda. Oh, there's tons of people. Fellini.
Yes. Well, with all of these, Betty Davis, right. These are very lucky people, because they are people who find something they want to do in life that they don't
That's
do just
luck.
For money.
They're gifted people,
They're gifted people,
artistic.
And intelligent, artistic, all of that. But I think they're lucky, too. I think that you're lucky, I'm lucky, anyone who gets to do what he or she wants to do in life.
No, luck is the coincidence of talent, opportunity, and the condition of readiness.
Yes,
Don't preach luck. Because that makes people say, oh, well, the reason I didn't do anything in life is I was unlucky.
Well, there are a lot of reasons why people don't do things in life. I think one of the things that might come out of all this is I enjoyed hearing people tell about how they found their answers and how they learned to go forward and not say no to themselves, but to make the effort you're talking about. But I still believe there are people out there who could have done something or could do something and who don't find that moment of timing in life that's right for them. Remember, Alan Shepard, the astronaut, told me, heroism is a matter of opportunity. There are millions of people out there who would be heroes if they had a moment in life where heroism was called for, but it's not.
You always say the appropriate and the pleasant. You always comfort. You don't ever ruffle or abrade.
Well, I hope that's true. I'd like it to be true. I'm sure there's somebody I'm not comforting, or someone who doesn't feel that way.
Which of the people you interviewed did you like the best?
It would be very difficult to say, but I suppose the most important person in my life is Groucho, because he was the subject of my whole first book. And indeed, he encouraged me.
He's the most important. Whom did you like the most?
Groucho is the one I knew best. He played such a big part in my life. And he also was a person I spent a great deal of time with. I stayed in his home. He came to New York, and I saw him here.
Was he married to Eden?
No, it was after that.
Oh, he was living with the nurse, Erin?
It was Erin Fleming. She was much involved in his life. She didn't actually live in his house, but she came there every afternoon and evening. And usually she wasn't there mornings in the early part of the day.
Was she his lover, do you think?
He said not. He told it all the time.
I didn't ask what he said. What did you think?
I believed him. He said only because he couldn't, only because it was too late, but that they were lovers in their heads and in compatibility and in sharing life. And he said she was the person he could tell if the toast was burnt in the morning and have meals with. And
you think Groucho was a millionaire?
Yes.
Groucho Bunker?
Yes.
Why did he leave her only $150,000?
It was what she asked for. And she did get some other things, too. She got a house, she got a fur coat, a car, some future participation in works that might happen. But we were riding in a car one day, and Groucho turned to her, and he said, "What do you think you ought to get, Erin? I'm making a will." And she said, $100,000, Grouch. And he said, "Okay." And she said, "Taxes paid." So he said, "All right, we'll go to the lawyers." And they did. I think that's the will that finally was the last will. If she'd said a great deal more, he would have given it to her.
Who did you like least?
Well, the interviews or conversations with Perón were not because he was a person I admired or chose to see for that reason, but because I thought it was interesting for history and to see him when I was in Madrid. So
He was in exile in Madrid.
He was in exile, yes.
The country of Argentina threw him out. And he had to run for his life. He was a fascist dictator.
He was actually about to go back to Argentina at the time that I saw him.
Right, and, but he was exiled.
He was there in exile, yes.
For good and sufficient reason.
And
do you think?
Well, he wasn't allowed to go back to Argentina. Certainly the Argentine government felt there'd be a revolution. He was not welcome there until that point when he was actually being brought back.
Now, Evita Perón was dead.
She'd been dead for more than 20 years.
Yeah, but her body was on the premises?
That was my most bizarre experience.
Well, tell me about
of all of the meetings with people. It's the only person in the book I couldn't interview or talk with, at least who didn't speak with me, and that was Eva Perón there on the sofa.
Wait a minute now. This audience, you know, will not easily absorb that a woman dead 20 years was in the room. She'd been Leninized, like Lenin.
Yes.
She'd been embalmed.
Actually, I was told
that
the
same husband,
person. Same embalmer, Dr.
Juan Perón, former dictator of Argentina, kept her embalmed body in the apartment?
No, actually it had just been brought there from Italy because they were taking it back to Argentina to put in a kind of glass case.
So while you were interviewing General Perón, the embalmed body of Evita Perón, his wife.
As close as you are to me now.
How did she look?
Very well, actually.
So there's an embalming.
Very small, very thin, and very pale.
Though dead people tend to look pale.
Especially after all this time. However, she didn't look, it wasn't as horrifying as I might have expected, but her embalmer was rather horrifying. He was all in black, like a horror movie.
He sat next to the casket?
He stood. There was no casket. And she was,
she
was on the sofa.
She was on the sofa?
Not quite sitting.
Did you think you were in a madhouse?
It was a strange and rare experience I don't ever expect to have again, nor did I really
but
expect
I asked
it
you,
to be
did
like that.
Did you think you were in a madhouse?
No, no, I understood what they were doing. They had a purpose.
What was the purpose?
They wanted the support of those people who supported Eva Perón when they went back to Argentina. And they were bringing the body back for that purpose, to be able to display it.
A 20-year dead body was going to be brought back to Argentina to rally the Peronistas.
Yes, to have that support.
The shirtless ones.
And we had petit four and cookies and tea, very elaborate silver teapot.
Did you feed any tea to the embalmed?
No, actually, I didn't have very much to eat myself. And Peron said, your appetite's not very good, is it? And his wife, Isabelita's third wife, kept passing cookies to me.
Oh, the new wife was in the
She was there. She
and the old wife
the tea.
Is embalmed. Right. It's a charming atmosphere. Just makes you want to go and visit. We'll be right back for more. I tell you, I'd like to indicate some of the people in the book, and you tell me the first thing that leaps into your mind. Pablo Picasso.
He told me that the reason he became an artist was for girls. He said that as a little boy, the first thought that he could remember ever having was thinking about sex. So I asked him what his second thought was, and he said it was the same. He said that when he was a little boy, he would look at little girls, and he would think about them, and he drew pictures, and they came and stood next to him. And as they stood next to him, he liked it. They admired what he did, and it was fun. And as he got a little bit older, he liked it even more. They stood closer. He liked it better. He got more girls, better girls. They said yes instead of no. And so he thought being an artist was a very good thing to be. But it was then, as he went on working, that the work took up more and more of his life. He found out that girls didn't like that. There weren't so many who were prepared to fit into that kind of life. So they pretended. But it didn't hold up because they couldn't pretend forever, or else maybe they thought they could do it.
No, he found
but they
four
couldn't do
that
it forever.
Pretty
well, he said that his last, Jacqueline, it was true, and it lasted because she felt about his work it was the same kind of priority that he gave it, and that the work became his life. And
that is a good way to get girls. If you draw a picture of a girl or do anything about her, she'll look at it. I wish I had thought of that.
You could start.
He's a voluptuary, wasn't he? He drank and he loved good food.
He loved life. He said that he never liked to miss a bullfight. He never liked to miss anything. And actually, one of the things that helped me a lot with him was that I discovered that Spanish was the right language for him. Originally, we began in French.
¿Hablo español?
Oh, yes, I did, and it was right for him because French produced a different personality in which he didn't speak very much.
Was the aura palpable, I mean, in his presence interviewing? How long did you do it?
I went several times, and it was many hours each time. And usually what I like is it's not just talking with a person in an interview situation, but at its best, I get to share something of the person's life. And at least we share some food. But
Did you feel a sexual magnetism?
He was very old when I met him, but it was a great deal of what he thought and talked about, and everything that he said had some kind of innuendo or some kind of sexual connotation.
Right,
and indeed, he drew a nude of me, although it was only half nude, only one side.
You didn't bring that with you?
I didn't bring it with me, no.
No, that's good.
He asked me if I'd like to have it, and he signed it. It was a very exaggerated picture. It really didn't look like me at all, except
if you have it
curls.
In your room somewhere?
I have it somewhere.
Really?
He signed it Pica,
okay,
P-I-C-A.
May West
didn't want to see me at all.
And, why?
She said women are a waste of time. And I think that part of the problem was that she couldn't play the games. But when I came there, she took pity on me.
Why did she see him?
Actually, George Cukor asked her to. I knew him. And she still had great hopes and dreams. He was the director of women. And she'd missed having him as her director. And even
well,
though
she wasn't
she was
making pictures anymore, she was 80 years old, for God's sake.
No, she was close to 90. But she still wanted to do it, and he was still alive.
She lived on Rossmore.
Yes.
Rossmore Street in Hollywood.
Yes.
The old Hollywood.
I know you went to see her, too. I'm sure your experience was very different from mine.
Yes, I went to see her to ask her to play a part in a Broadway musical about herself. And she was very old. She's going to be looking back at her life. Mm-hmm. I found it slightly ridiculous because, you know, she's all corseted and she had a huge chest. Didn't you think she was kind of an 88-year-old woman?
Well, actually, her skin was very soft.
I didn't ask you that, dear. I said, did you think
she looked ridiculous? No, she didn't look ridiculous to me.
With the eyelashes on?
Yes.
In fact, at 88?
That was one of my funniest experiences. I was sitting with her, and I heard this strange sound in the room, and I wondered what the sound was, and I looked around. I thought there were little birds in cages, and I couldn't find any, and I realized it was her eyelashes brushing her cheeks that sounded like little birds' wings fluttering because she had so much mascara. But we had a good time. When I shook her hand, she noticed that I didn't have any diamonds. She looked at my hands and she said, oh, you poor thing, you don't have any. And then she said, you left them at home? And I hadn't left them at home. So because of that, she tried to give me a lot of tips.
Did she give you a diamond?
No, she gave me some baby oil.
Baby oil?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, she said the trick was to use it warm and a man had to put it on.
And did you do that?
And that would keep your youth.
Have you tried that?
Actually, I left without my baby oil. She gave it to me, and it was the last time I saw her, so I missed the baby oil.
Right. Henry Fonda's biography by Howard Teichman is a brilliant piece of work. Teichman took hundreds of hours of tape interviews and questions and answers, and then wrote what I think is definitive biography. How did you react to Henry Fonda?
Well, I had a wonderful time with him. I met him very late in his life.
Was he ill?
He was already ill, but not as ill as he was later. He was still performing, and he still was leading something of a good life, and there were hopes. But he told me that I was going to be disappointed in him. The first thing he said to me is, I ain't really Henry Fonda. Nobody could be. Nobody could have that much integrity. And he said he was a person who never had written about himself, partly because he didn't like to write about painful memories of the past. There were a lot of painful things in his own life.
Yeah. Well,
that he didn't want to relive those. And also because he was, in life, a modest person who felt that he really hadn't lived such a dramatic life, that he'd been other people, and that whatever he did in life, he couldn't live up to that image that people had of all of the characters he'd been.
Yes, well, Henry Fonda was a friend of mine. Acquaintance is a better word. And I admired him greatly. One of the finest actors we ever had in films and theater. And I've read his book 1.5 times, Howard Teichman's biography. And you know what he says in the signed introduction? He says, this story Teichman tells about me is true. And I have a regret. 5 marriages, as I look back on my life, is unthinkable. But I did it.
He said that he was deeply ashamed of that and felt some kind of terrible failure because what he admired was his parents' romance when they would walk out and have ice cream sodas holding hands. But actually, it seems he had to be an ongoing romantic to have faith in that many times and hopes. And was a romantic person, and he found what he wanted with Shirley Fonda.
Well, there were two tragic endings of two wives. They took their own lives.
Yes.
And I think that deeply, deeply affected him.
It did, because he said suicide to him was unimaginable, that he loved life so much, and that he loved his work, the acting. He said he could do the acting. He didn't need that success that he had. He needed to be able to do it. And that if he ever had a part where you wondered why he'd done that, it was never money, but it was because he just had to work, and he always had higher hopes or that he could make something out of it, but that the thought of not working was the real death for him.
Isn't the apogee of brilliance and integrity as a performer that there is no bad performance of Henry Fonda in any medium, theater, motion pictures, television? Everything he did was Tiffany, Cartier's. It was fine. He was the ultimate class act.
He's the only actor I've known who said he liked doing something for the 4,000th time better than for the first time because it gave him that chance to work on it, to get it right. And there was always the feeling you could do more, that you didn't have it right. And the terrible thing, if it ended, even Mr. Roberts, after so many years, that still maybe one more performance and there was something greater ahead for you. And he couldn't believe people actually got bored with what they were doing, or that they stood on a stage and the lines came automatically, or that, even worse, they didn't listen when the other people said the lines.
Would he be among the very few in the book that you admire totally?
No, I had a lot of admiration for a great many of the people because I made an effort to select people who had achievement rather than just people who are lottery winners.
You like all achievers?
It wouldn't mean that I'd like them all personally, no, and of course I'd have my judgment of the achievement. But I like it when the people shape their own lives to some extent. And when it doesn't just happen to them, it's wonderful if it does, it's a gift. But if they can make an ongoing life out of it and go on with it and care that much and have a standard of perfection, something they want to achieve, I'm happier with it. It's why I like people like Mae West and Groucho Marx, because they wrote so much of their own material and created what they did and went on for such a long time. People like Chagall and Henry Moore, who's part of this, or Tennessee Williams, they're part of all our lives.
That's true. I have to pause. We'll be right back. We have another friend in common, Tennessee Williams, and you have him saying, "Nobody who knew my day-to-day life would envy me."
Yes, that actually gives the title to the last part of my book, in which all of these people explore the idea of whether success really equals happiness, because it's what they looked for, it's what everyone looks for. And the original belief was
they look
for happiness.
What happened?
And the belief is that if you have success, you'll have happiness. And if you have happiness, you won't be lonely. And Picasso told me he thought everything would taste better, everything would feel better. But the people don't always find happiness, and one who did not was Tennessee Williams.
Where'd you meet him?
I met him in New York at a cocktail party, the person you always hope you're going to sit next to on an airplane or meet at a cocktail party. I went to
Milton Goldman's party.
Yes, it was Milton Goldman's apartment. And actually, Milton said, "Miss Chandler, Mr. Williams," and I didn't hear his name, or I didn't really realize I heard his name. I didn't recognize him. And I spent about 20 minutes with him before I knew who he was, which was very interesting for me and later for him, because there was nothing to interfere, no idea that this is Tennessee Williams. So I knew him only as a person. And I remember when I saw Jean-Paul Sartre in Paris, he said, "You mustn't meet people with a preconception or you'll be disappointed by them." And I tried not to do that, but of course with Tennessee Williams, I could have none at all.
Couldn't
since
y'all
I didn't know.
Pick up that little Southern accent right away? Why did you have to spend 20 minutes, y'all, with Tennessee before you knew it was Tennessee?
It wasn't until Douglas Fairbanks Jr., who was also at the party, came over after rather a long time and said, "Tennessee, do you remember that night we were at the White House?" And that's when I remembered the Mr. Williams. But before that, he'd said to me that we were having an interesting conversation, at least it was very interesting for me. And he'd said, "I would ask you to have dinner with me one night, except I'm leaving New York. I'm going back to Key West." He asked me if I'd been there, and I hadn't. And he asked me if I knew about the sunsets in Key West. And I said I didn't. He said, "It's the greatest sunset." And then he said, "Why don't you have dinner with me? Come back tomorrow night and see the sunset and have dinner." And I didn't accept the invitation for the next night, but I did go a few days later.
Were you his guest? Did you pay your own ticket or what?
Well, actually, he invited me to stay at his house.
Right. So you bought your plane ticket.
I bought the ticket.
And you were a house guest.
I didn't know I wasn't. I rejected the invitation to stay at his house. And I must say that hurt, not just because of paying for the hotel, but because I think it was a real experience to stay at his house. But it seemed to me wrong to accept an invitation like that. And besides, I was afraid he might regret it, that he'd offered too much and would feel stuck with it. So I told him that I would love to stay at his house, but I was going to stay at the hotel, anyone that he selected. And
the Key West hotels aren't that nice. I've been down.
I was at the Pier House, and he selected it. But I told him that the next time, if he invited me to come back, I would stay at his house.
Did he ever invite you back?
Actually, he died not so long after. And it was
then
really...
you met him in his drug phase and his drunken phase.
Not really, because that had been earlier. And so it wasn't the worst part of all
no,
that time.
No, I didn't say it was the worst part. I said when you
Although
met
I
him,
can't really compare because I didn't know him during
no, we're not
the bad
about
time.
Bad, worse, worst. We're talking about you met him when he was on drugs and alcohol.
At the night I met him, as far as I know, there weren't any drugs. He wasn't on drugs, but I don't know. Anyway, he was
Nobody
very
Nobody you've ever known or interviewed in this book was on drugs or drank excessively.
Well, Tennessee Williams drank quite a lot while I was interviewing him. That I could see. And in fact, I really didn't realize how much he was drinking until we took one of the photographs. And he kept saying to me, "I don't drink. I don't drink at all. A little bit of white wine." He would order the white wine. And I was very much engrossed in what he was saying. And I knew there were a couple of bottles of white wine, and I wasn't drinking it. So I realized he was drinking that. But then there were more bottles than I realized when I got the photograph.
And not all white wine. Vodka.
It was all white wine.
Was it?
With me.
Because I once went to see him about producing 3 by Tennessee, which we did. And it was vodka. And I had to pretend I was drinking it with him.
I didn't have to pretend. He didn't care. I was lucky I was a white wine person.
Right. Is there anybody in the book that you didn't like at all, besides some questions about Juan Perón and the embalmed Evita?
No, except for that. I couldn't say there was anyone in the book I didn't like at all.
One chapter that interested me a lot was the woman I think is the greatest actress in movie history in this country, Betty Davis.
She's another person who didn't get total happiness from what she did.
You know anybody has total happiness?
I think that someone like Henry Moore has had a wonderful life and enjoys what he does. Of course, he's old now, and it's sad to not be able to do what you always did, but he's saved drawing, which he loves, and he's able to do that.
Did you come away with the feeling that there's some greatness palpable in Betty Davis?
I've had a very interesting time with her, and I thought she brought up one of the points that's interesting and expressed it a lot for the women in the book, who all talked about how much harder it was for them to have the happy life, in which they combined the professional life and the personal life, where the work was a competitor for the personal life. And Betty Davis would say to me that all of those qualities women admire so much in a man, men don't admire at all in a woman.
But didn't you detect in Betty Davis that she was a breed apart? She's a Newton, Massachusetts, born and bred woman. She had class. She had tone. She may have been a great movie actress, but she was a great lady.
I agree with you.
Is a great lady.
I agree with you. She is.
Would she be among your favorites in the book?
Yes, she was a favorite.
Because in the entire acting profession, she's my all-time favorite woman.
Oh, isn't that wonderful? I know she'll be glad to hear that. But
oh, she knows that.
Yeah,
I think you've written her
wonderful as an actress and a person.
You've written a wonderful book of interviews. And if you care about Henry Moore, Henry Fonda, Mae West, Betty Davis, Pablo Picasso, and a host of others, I recommend that you read the interviews with them by Charlotte Chandler. Thank you for being with us.
I really appreciate it. A very great pleasure. I appreciate it.
We're coming right back. That's it for tonight. Thank you for being with us. Join us again next week at the same time. Till then, good night.
The Luangwa Valley in Zambia contains one of the greatest concentrations of large animals in Africa. The Luangwa Valley is Africa as everyone dreams of it. Here, mankind barely exists. The Last Kingdom of the Elephants, next time on Living Wild.
Another Living Wild adventure, Sunday at 7. This is WTTW, Channel 11, Chicago. Enterprise is presented by WGBH Boston.
in co-production with Kentucky Educational Television, with grants from public television stations. The Dun & Bradstreet Corporation, providing business and information services worldwide. Merrill Lynch Pierce Fenner & Smith Incorporated, a breed apart. Charles E. Culpepper Foundation and the Gates Foundation.
350 in Manassas, 7 in the Medicaid, 75 in the Medicaid, 350, all true, 75 anywhere, 350 and... about that, 375, 4. 4!
This yearling is being auctioned off at the Keeneland Summer Select Sale in Lexington, Kentucky, where the world's top thoroughbreds are sold. Horse breeder Tom Gentry paid $320,000 for her and is gambling he can sell her for nearly twice that. This week on Enterprise, Fast Horse in a Bull Market.
I'm Eric Sevareid. Owning a stable of fast racehorses is one way to win at the track. But the real money in thoroughbreds isn't made in the winner's circle, it's made in the breeding shed. Some of the richest people in the world put their money into horses. For those who can afford the top bloodlines, it's been an inflation-proof investment. Yearling prices have more than tripled in the last decade. Last summer at Keeneland, Kentucky's premier auction, average yearling prices were up 25%, with some horses bringing multi-million dollar bids. But this market, like any other, is filled with uncertainty. The vast majority of horses bring less than expected, often less than it costs to raise them. We begin our story 3 years ago as a horse breeder prepares to sell his most promising filly.
Eloise, hi, honey.
Tom Gentry of Lexington, Kentucky is in the business of producing thoroughbred racehorses. He's helped turn the sport of kings into a money machine.
Okay, well, I've got a mare foal and I'll call him back. We'll be home in a half an hour. Okay, huh?
Every spring, some 50 brood mares on his farm give birth. Gentry sells most of the foals a year later as yearlings, but some he keeps to produce still more foals.
Girl.
This mare has given birth to more than $1 million worth of offspring. In a few hours, this foal will be insured for $300,000.
Billy's asleep, and he's got his left front leg sticking out. He's asleep, the colt's asleep, and everybody's asleep. Look sharp, Billy, wake up. Ricky, set your muscles in order. All right, get the best filly in the sale. I'm going to start you out right. Sire, dam, and hip number, $2.
There's a $2 bonus for farmhands who can recite the pedigrees of Gentry's yearlings, a rehearsal for the Keeneland auction just 3 weeks away.
This guy standing over here worth $100 million, and he's got 100 horses to look at, and he's in a hurry. And if you don't run to the stall and bring him out, he's going to turn around and go somewhere else. All right, get your best filly in the sale. Voice of play, Summit Joyce.
Of the 12 yearlings he's selling at Keeneland, this is the prize. She was raised by another breeder, but Gentry thought so much of her potential, he bought her for $320,000 6 months ago. He hopes to auction her off for at least $500,000. Why would anyone pay that much? Because of her pedigree, her bloodline. Her father is Hoist the Flag, a champion racehorse that sired other champions, including Alleged. Her mother is Summit Joy, a champion too. She produced Himalayan, another winner. So the Hoist the Flag filly, as she's called, has the potential to become both a great racehorse herself and the mother of other big winners. But that doesn't mean she's a sure thing.
Approximately the middle of May, the Hoist the Flag filly developed what we call sesamoids, and it just more or less came up overnight. And the sesamoids are the joints right behind a horse's ankle. And what happens, there's a little bone on each corner. Normally, they're very tight together. In this case, they're starting to really go out to a point. And gee, sometimes they never bother them, and you can x-ray and all that. But one thing I knew immediately, if I was going to...